Alright, this is going to be Holly riding Mr. T with two reins a little bit, and then I'm going to go over there and lunge him. And I talk about getting behind a power curve. Go ahead and bring him over here, Holly. She's got two reins now, so she should have a little bit more control. You're going to see her hand kind of drop down. Mr. T wanted to go over to Buddy. Go ahead and stop him. There you go. Easy, easy, good. Alright, so I'm going to have her ride him around with just two reins a little bit just to see him. So just go maybe take him to the corner, take him to the fence or whatever. I'm just going to just put him through a couple trials. I may have you do a couple things in a second if I see that he's kind of taking advantage of you. He wants to prance. He wants to go. He's got Buddy tied up. He's ready to go. So if you can try and stay calm, he'll try and stay calm. Be ready to pick up that rein, turn him the other way, make him turn around. Nice. He's going back. He wants to prance. She picked up that other rein, turn him the other way. He's going to want to prance. She'll pick up that rein again, slow him down. Go ahead and have him face me and stop. Good boy, Mr. T. Okay, so what I'm going to do here, and I'm going to do it right on that willow wood spot there, is I'm going to take that lead rope, and I'm going to try and get Holly off balance with Mr. T. And her job is going to be to stay in balance. So I'm going to have a lead rope, and I'm going to lunge Mr. T. She's going to have no reins, and her job is not to hang onto the horn and do a death grip. Her job is to stay neutral and center and anticipate where Mr. T goes through field, beat him there, and come back center. If Mr. T gets too far this way, you're going to see her body over here. She's going to have to adjust up. If he gets too far this way, you're going to see her body over here, and then she's going to have to catch up. And that's what I'm talking about. You shouldn't be playing catch up with your horse. You have to be anticipating, I feel him moving this way. Instead of ending up here, I feel him moving that way. I'm going to get ahead of him. He's going to move here, and we're both going to come up straight and soft. He's going to move here. I'm leaning and anticipating. He moves quick, and I come up straight and tall, and we're together. It should look like this versus, or, and they're catching up. I don't like seeing riders playing catch-up, so I'm going to try and make her play catch-up. Mr. T is. I'm just going to lunge him. Mr. T! So her job is to pretty much keep her arms and hands neutral. Mr. T kind of come around. You should not see her shoulders be twisting. You shouldn't see her arms going up. You shouldn't see her catching up to the horse after he moves. She should be anticipating with timing and rhythm on where this horse goes. When he slows down, I'm going to be ready to back up softly with him. I don't want him stopping me going forward and have to lean back. I don't want him taking off and me going way back and have to catch up. I don't want him going this way, my body's still here, and then I have to catch up. It should be smooth. So I'm going to do it slow so you can see what smooth looks like. Then I'm going to make Mr. T get her behind. Now, she's concentrating on a lot of things right now, and that's when I say horsemanship is complex. Because when you start looking at hands, head position, bit, pain, spurs, stirrups, kicking, whip, crop, and you lose focus on the little things. Her only job is to focus on staying center, staying out of the way of the horse, being an easy, even load that moves with the horse fluidly instead of jerky and opposite and catching up and all that. That's when people talk about rhythm. If something is fluid, if it's smooth, if it looks like it has timing, bad rhythm, it doesn't look fluid, is when you get this jerking sack of potatoes, legs all up, and they're trying to catch up, and this horse is crazy, he won't stop. That's what I'm talking about, sloppy. That's when a horse gets nervous, because he's got this crap load of potatoes on his back flopping around. She wants to be a good, solid backpack connected to that saddle and stirrups and become one with the horse. That's fluid, that's smooth. So watch your shoulders, watch your body, watch your legs. It should look smooth. Mr. T's moving smooth, she should look smooth. Ready, Mr. T? Now going forward and soft in a slow motion, pretty easy. If I disengage his hips, little tougher. She had to anticipate and straighten up a little bit because she doesn't know when I'm going to disengage those hips. She doesn't know when Mr. T's going to move right. But if she concentrates on feel and staying in that center, it teaches her to remember that. So later, as she gets better, she does it all the time, that becomes second nature. Then she doesn't have to think about it. Much like riding with one rein. Once you learn to reach with one rein, when your horse takes off spoots or bucks, it's instinctive. That's one less thing you have to think about. Your body already knows, when my horse does this, I grab one rein. That's one less thing you got to concentrate on. That gives you more time to concentrate. Which way am I going to go? How hard do I pull? Am I going to pull because he's in pain? Do I want to let him go a few steps? Do I want to back him up? Do I really want to lock his head in? All those decisions can get your focus because you don't have to think, oh shit, he's running. I got two reins. I got to get one rein. Oh, how did I do that? My right hand's in the wrong position. That causes lag time. I talk about that in a few other videos. That lag time is that decision time. You have all these options. Something happens. You have to formulate what's happening, what do you need to do, what options you have, and then pick the best option. All that creates lag time. Lag time increases, the horse gets confused because he's not getting direction in that lag time. The more he doesn't get direction, the more he goes into instinctive, holy shit, I don't have a rider, I'm not getting told anything, I'm gonna butt, get rid of this rider and haul butt. Because your response time is too slow. Good horsemen don't have to think about doing that because they've done it enough. So, we're gonna do it again. Mr. T, let's go this way. Watch his body, I'm gonna disengage these hips. Stayed pretty straight. Didn't lean, there was no catch up. Now we're gonna turn up the heat a little bit. Ready, Mr. T? Let's go. See that body going forward and backwards? Mr. T's very jerky, powerful horse, so don't think this is easy. Good. You notice how she stopped slowly and smoothly and not, there's not jerky. You notice how it's not interfering with Mr. T stopping. He's not losing his balance because she's behind him catching up. She's being a good load. Because as he moves, she's moving with him. She's concentrating. Why? Because she's not worried about reaching the reins. She's not throwing off her balance. She's not looking down for the reins. She's not using her shoulders. She's not reaching across the body. All that detracts from what she's doing now because she's concentrating on one thing. That's why when you ride with one rein, you can't make a mistake and pull on two. You only have one. It forces you to learn to work with one rein. So when you have two reins, you don't have to think about using one rein. You've done it so much, it's second nature. Now we're gonna trot a little bit quicker. She's gonna anticipate when he stops and when he turns. She's balancing on her knees, balancing. She's gonna stop right here, ready, and stop. Now she's kind of overcompensating. You see her shoulder? You're gonna look at this and you're gonna, did you see her shoulder kind of turn with him, before him? She's anticipating and she's doing the right thing, but she's overcompensating. She doesn't need to do it that much because she hasn't done it a lot, because she don't have the security of these reins to help pull her in. She's compensating more. This time I don't want your shoulders to move. Try to keep your shoulders straight and stay focused on him and stay center on him. We're gonna do it again. See if we don't get those shoulders twisting. Much better. It looks smoother. I'm not watching her that much. I'm kind of concentrating on his teeth, but I can just tell out of my peripheral vision that looked smoother. She looked more confident. She looked more centered. She didn't look like she was trying to stay centered. She just simply moved and stayed centered. That's what we're talking about when we're talking about refining and getting better. Turn up the heat a little bit more. Let's go, Miss T. Yeah, that's a good jump. Keep those hands low. A little better, fell. You see that? I hope y'all saw that. She lost her balance. She was behind the power curve.
and it pulled Mr. T off step. That's when some horses who are insecure and new will panic. They're like, holy shit, she's trying to tackle me. Wow, she's trying to pull me down. I'm gonna run this away. Then a person goes, stupid horse, I was stopping and it ran that away. It ran that away because your dumb ass was behind the power curve. When you lean this way, the horse moved away from your pressure. Staying center is really important, and it's hard for me to show that when I'm riding, and everybody gets off center. Everybody. Either your horse jumps, he flinches, you're not ready, you're not paying attention 100%, and you get off center. But as you get better, you don't have to think about staying centered. It becomes second nature. You don't have to be adjusting that saddle. Somebody that's always adjusting their saddle, they're not staying centered. They're pulling that saddle off all the time because they're behind a power curve, so they're always constantly straightening it. Why are they straightening it? Because they didn't prevent it from spinning. Okay? Prevention is better than correction. It's easy to correct the saddle when it gets off. It's better to prevent it from getting off. So you ride center. When the horse moves, you anticipate. If I'm riding my horse and I feel my saddle a little off left, if he's running, I'm not gonna try and adjust that while he's running. I'll throw his boat on the ground, I'll throw him off balance, he may trip. But what I will do is when I stop him, I'm gonna turn. So inertia or centrifugal force, if my saddle's leaning this way, I'm gonna stop him this way. And as we stop, it's gonna correct that saddle a little bit. I'm gonna let the horse's stopping motion correct the saddle. That way I don't have to pull it and jerk it. I can make these minor adjustments if I think ahead and realize the saddle's a little off, I need to correct that. Mr. T? Come on. It's like, dude, what'd I do? Come on. Come on. Hey, resistance. This horse got screwed up. What's happening? Why ain't he working? Rick, he doesn't work. My horse won't lunge because I'm doing the same damn thing. He'll lunge. He's just gonna make me do more than I normally did. Earlier he was doing this fine. He's telling me, you know what, I kinda tired of running, I don't really want to. Do I really have to? Yeah, you really have to. How does he know that? Watch this. Now he knows he really has to. Mr. D, you go, old boy. Honking, she's staying centered, heels are down, relaxing the saddle. She gets off balance, she sucks her stomach in, that'll tighten that core center. When you hold your stomach in, they say touch your belly button to your back. That really tightens up that core center, and that helps you when a horse moves. Told me no. I should stop. He don't want me to touch his ear. No, you don't stop, you big dummy. I give him directions. Say, come here, give me your ear. Can't tell me no. Head. Poor Mr. T. Oh, I did so mean to you. All right, Holly. This horse shouldn't be acting like it. Come here. He's telling me he needs to be sacked out. So you know what? I gotta sack him out. I should be able to throw a rope around a horse without him freaking out. He did that because I had to get in his butt a few minutes ago and make him run. So when I looked at a rope, he was like, oh shit, he wants me to run. Just a little confusion. I gotta correct that confusion. I wanna make sure he knows that if I throw a rope and it goes over his head, he ain't gotta be flinching on me. So now when I throw it to Holly, it should look like that, and not like it looked before I did it. All right, staying centered, being a good load, staying balanced, don't get behind the horse, keeping your saddle straight. If you're always adjusting your saddle, you're doing it wrong. Mr. T, you did all right. You told me no once. I'm sacking out the cat right now. If you have cat problems that are scared of paper bags or stuff, I'll sack them out for you. Send me your cat, $200. When you get him back, he won't be scared of a plastic bag. And that cat was abused, neglected, oxygen deprived. His mom abandoned him. It had bad owners, and I bought it at a kill sale. So I've got all the excuses on why that horse or why that cat shouldn't be scared of plastic bags, and yet he got over it because he's a good boy. Good boy, Smokey. Mr. T, you're a good boy too. Thanks, Ollie. See ya.